So again, welcome to the Association of Internet Researchers public panel to discuss the important topic of who rules the internet. I'm Jennifer Stromer-Galley. I am a professor at Syracuse University in the United States, and I have the honor of being president of the Association of Internet Researchers. Aww. I have to do a little shift. Let's see if I don't break the PowerPoint. Okay, good. For those of you who are new to the Association of Internet Researchers, or AIR for short, this is our 17th conference. We are an international organization that brings together scholars who collectively seek to examine and to understand the complex information and communication environment that all started with the internet, and that now includes mobile phones, social media, corporate conglomerates and governments that regulate, control, and dictate the content and flow of the information, entertainment, and community that we experience daily. But I'm getting ahead of what the content of the panel is. Before we begin to dive too deeply into exactly those issues around governance and control, I want to take a moment to acknowledge this amazing city where we are meeting this week. In fact, I got a fantastic little boat tour this afternoon down the Spree. Although the weather has not quite favored us, the city architecture and the history provide an enticing distraction and also an important backdrop to the intellectual work that has brought us together. I sincerely thank my colleagues at the Alexander von Humboldt Institute for Internet and Society and the Hans Bredow Institute for Media Research for all of their care and time and support to make this conference an incredible success. I also want to thank Humboldt University for their generous hospitality in providing to us these beautiful facilities and allowing us to meet and plan and talk together. To kick off our discussion tonight, I'd like to welcome Herr Matthias Graf von Kilmansegg. He is Directorate of Strategies, he is Head of Directorate of Strategies and Policy Issues. He's speaking on behalf of Frau Johanna Vanka, Federal Minister of Education and Research. She would have liked to be here, but she had another engagement this evening. In correspondence, she expressed great interest in our topic tonight and the ideas that we're engaging here at AOIR. We are fortunate that she has sent Herr Graf von Kilmansegg to welcome us to Germany. And in turn, please join me in welcoming Herr Graf von Kilmansegg to AOIR. Please join me in welcoming. Yes, please.
Is that okay if I close this one here? Great. I'm still with my paper, not in the digital age. Still a bit on printing, relying on a bit of printing. So, dear Professor Stromer-Galley, dear Professor Schulze, dear Dr. Puschmann, and distinguished guests, thank you very much for the invitation to this annual conference of the Association of Internet Researchers, which has come to Germany and Berlin, as I have learned, for the first time in its history. I do hope it will not be the last time. I would also like to bring the best wishes from Minister Professor Vanka. It has already been mentioned, who cannot be here herself tonight. We have a parliamentary term, and there are a lot of talks, discussions, and meetings going on. But let me assure you that she takes a great interest in digitization and its impacts on economy and society. This includes many subjects that you are covering in your fields of research and in this particular conference. For those of you that are not too familiar with German digitization policy, let me start with a few words on our national digital agenda, as we call it. It was 2 years ago that the German federal government, for the first time, published a digital agenda. This agenda is a multi-perspective approach and includes aims and activities for all ministries, from technical infrastructure to legal or security issues. Each ministry is in charge of bringing forward its own topics, and the overall process is steered through a high-level interministerial group. In terms of activities, it concentrates on the legislative term of 2013 until 2017, that is next year. Then we have to prolong it and develop it. But with regards to principles of action and to strategic targets, it reaches out far into the next decade. In addition to this, we have an annual national IT summit, including preparatory bodies. This forum is used for a constant dialogue with the private business sector, the unions, the scientific world, and society. And it is not just about dialogue. There are also quite a number of common strategic initiatives emerging from this forum. Such as you might know, we call Industry 4.0, Industry 4.0. I guess this branding is already used in German terms also in other countries. So obviously, what is the role of the Ministry of Education Research in this digital agenda? You all know, I don't have to convince you, that digitization is a fundamental game changer, and thus refers not just to the way our economies offer new services and produce goods in a different manner. More important, it changes the way we create knowledge and we accumulate it. It changes the way we communicate, we collaborate, we decide what is important for our life. So digitization also loosens our ties to time and to place. And we're definitely not at the end, but somewhere in the midst of this rapid process. I just might remind you, Wikipedia was founded 16 years ago. The first iPhone was introduced no more than 9 years ago. Now we talk about the possible effects of blockchain technologies or artificial intelligence. So we definitely do not know how the world will look like in 10 or 20 years. And though we have to make decisions for our own life and on the political level also for our society, education and research are therefore of vital importance. Good education and research policy does not only react to inevitable changes. Rather than that, we need to seize the opportunities that come along with digitization proactively. There is no doubt that research is one of the major drivers of digitization. In Germany, we are focusing on implementing the Internet of Things into our core industrial branches. We go into autonomous driving, precision medicine, smart living, smart cities, and various fields of sustainability. In Germany, traditionally, we used to have a rather technology-driven understanding of innovation processes. With the governmental strategy for innovation, which came into power 2 years ago, we now focus also on the economic and cultural framework, the ecosystems, as we used to call this, that allow to grow digital solutions for production and services in a quite rapid and massive way. But research being driver is just one aspect. The other aspect is that science, research, and education themselves are users of digitization. So our approach in our ministry is based on several strategic pillars. Let me start with education, because it's the basis of all subsequent stages and it concerns especially the young generation. And here we have to answer some major questions. What will determine the further development of digital education? Is it technology or pedagogy? Who will be the change agents we will have to rely on? Will it be the edtechs or the teachers? So our answer is, in the end, everything depends on the teachers and the schools and their willingness to take an active role in this change. So we will have to secure the dominance of pedagogy. It is vital that we use digital educational media to contribute to realizing our overall educational policy goals, and not vice versa. So these are participation, permeability, and equal opportunities. To reach these goals, digital education media offer new possibilities, definitely, through more individual support, more effective learning, through a widened access of educational offers, a greater potential for creative development, and a better preparation for tomorrow's world of work. So to bring all this forward, we are planning to start an education campaign for the Digital Knowledge Society, that's how we name it. This campaign will develop answers to questions such as, how do we enable young people to find their place in a digital society? How can we prepare them for changing workplaces? And how can we avoid the digital divide of our society? Our educational campaign is directed towards all education levels, that is, schools, our vocational education and training system, which is of great importance for our economic model, and also for higher education. So there we will be talking about new content, and about open education resources, about qualification, and of course also about the technical infrastructure. And not to forget also, especially Germany, we'll have to look for a better framework concerning the legal framework, the questions of data security and education-friendly copyright law. So all this is done in Germany in a close cooperation with our 16 federal states that have their own responsibilities, particularly in school matters. So equally important and closer to your day-to-day work as researchers is the digitization of science. Modern science creates huge amounts of data. Big data is no fiction but reality. Smart data will be the next step, and it is already on its way. The challenge that politics, universities, and research organizations are facing is now to create an infrastructure that is capable of handling and giving access to these data. To this end, we need new scientific methods and new rules for accessing and deploying data. We call it securing the life cycle of data. So it's about creating, saving, analyzing, verifying, then second and third use, readability when technical standards will have changed. So we are talking about quite some difficult questions of governance too. Who will decide what to save and what to delete? Who will be responsible for each stage in this life cycle? What are the criteria of access for third parties, be it from the scientific world or be it from the business world? Another challenge lies in hardware. The use of big data goes along with hardware requirements, in particular high-performance computing. The federal government and the federal states, which are responsible in Germany for the basic funding of the universities, are working on a common approach to meet these challenges, and we plan to launch an initiative of action next year. While doing so, we will rely on advice from a newly established Council for Scientific Information Infrastructures. This body consists of representatives from scientific institutions as well as from society and politics, and it accompanies the digital transformation in science. Only in September, that is 3 weeks ago, we have announced an open access strategy of the Federal Ministry of Education Research. With this strategy, we want to promote open access as a publishing culture that promises wider access to scientific knowledge. To this end, we will start a number of measures that includes an information campaign to spread knowledge, a dialogue forum to discuss open questions and exchange experience. It's about counseling and support for innovative approaches, and it's about monitoring of progress. And we have added new provisions to our own funding conditions. Any article in a scientific journal that is based on the results from the projects financed through our ministry shall be published open access. So, for my last point, I'm sure I do not have to convince this audience. You all bear witness that digital transformation is a research topic in itself. The societal implications of digitization are way more comprehensive than those of other technological innovations. Hence, we need to know more about possibilities and consequences of digitization. And to this end, the federal government has decided to establish a German Internet Institute. We do know that there are strong players in Germany in the field of digitization and research. And I assume a number of you, among this audience. A number of you might be working in German research organizations and institutions and universities dealing with that topic. So the government has decided to take advantage of these resources and to give an additional incentive to establish a strong research institution of international excellence. It shall contribute to a clearer evidence base by investigating a number of issues with strategic importance. It's about access to and participation in the digital world, privacy and self-determination, governance and regulation, and also, in a broader sense, consequences for work, for value creation, and our democracy. So we want to support a broad interdisciplinary expert team of social scientists, economists, legal experts, as well as information scientists, cooperating in this German Internet Institute. And we expect that knowledge transfer will benefit society, politics, and the economy. And of course, we do hope that the future German Internet Institute will contribute to international scientific debate like this one. The competitive selection process for the German Internet Institute is just underway. We expect the winner to be announced next spring. So you will know it when you will have your next conference in 2017. Our ministry is willing to spend up to 15 million euros for the first 5 years to kickstart this institute's work. And then we'll have an evaluation and see how we can go on. So dear ladies and gentlemen, this short input was meant to highlight important policy measures that accompany the digital transformation in Germany. For the rest of your conference, you will go into many more detailed questions. You probably have done so yesterday and today. And I'm very interested in also listening to the following panel. I'm sure that will be very interesting and you will have, and I do hope so, intense discussions. Let me just make one last remark. So the overall title of this conference is Internet Rules, with the exclamation mark, as I've seen. So there are some prophets of a digital doomsday soon to come who say it's not internet rules, it's rather internet fools. So this is not my position, to make it clear. It is still up to us to be the fool or the wise. But I do understand this title as a kind of provocative headline to draw the attention to what will happen if politics, science, economy, and society do not find common answers to the new challenges. So the political actions I've laid out in my remarks all aim, in the end, at the same purpose, that we will be able to say also in a digital world, it's not internet that rules, it's still democracy that rules. We do need you and your work to have success by pursuing that aim. So thank you very much for your invitation and your attention, and have good discussions further on. Thank you very much.
So now, thank you very much for those remarks. I am intrigued by the idea of a German Internet Institute that is supported by the government. Perhaps we need to challenge the United States to consider something equally important for this work. Now, for what we're really waiting for is this lively discussion. And so for that, I would like to introduce Cornelius Puschmann. He is a senior researcher with the Hans Bredow Institute for Media Research and the Alexander von Humboldt Institute for Internet and Society. He serves as AOIR's program chair, which means that he gets the enviable task of envisioning the conference theme. Now, his idea to tackle the challenging topic of who owns the internet was a prescient one, and I look forward to this public panel discussion. So please join me in welcoming Cornelius Puschmann.
Thank you. Oh, this is on already. Wonderful. So I will proceed straight to this position here for the simple reason that I want to no longer keep you waiting and proceed straight to introducing our wonderful panelists for tonight. And I will introduce them one by one, and they will take their place. And then after they have made a brief statement, a brief provocation on the topic of this panel discussion, and then after they've all three made their statements, we will actually start discussing. So don't worry, in case you were concerned whether this would actually take place. So the first panelist that I'm absolutely honored to introduce is Kate Crawford. Kate is an expert on the complex social impacts of large-scale data, machine learning, and artificial intelligence. She is, as many of you know, principal researcher at Microsoft Research, a visiting professor at MIT, and a senior fellow at the NYU Information Law Institute. She is also on the World Economic Forum's Council on AI and Robotics, and she recently co-chaired the White House Symposium on AI Now, the Social and Economic Implications of AI in the Near Term. She's also a member of the feminist art and technology collective Deep Lab. So give a warm welcome to Kate Crawford.
Well, good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for being here. And thank you, Cornelius, for such a lovely introduction. It is, for me, like a complete pleasure and an honor to be presenting here at AIR 2016 and to look out and to see so many friends and dear colleagues in the audience. So when Cornelius asked me to think about this question, who rules the internet? First thing I did was, of course, look at my bookshelf. And what did I see but a whole lot of people in this community who have written books on this very topic. Some of you are actually in the room, and I'm looking at you right now. And what was interesting was flicking through these books, I realized how much this group of researchers have been so instrumental in moving us beyond the somewhat naive idealism and utopianism of the 1990s, where we had this idea that somehow the internet was borderless and control-free, into thinking about something much more granular, to think about the social, the technical, and the infrastructural layers. So I think what's happened now is that we can really think about the internet as a very complex stack. It begins with, say, the network protocol layer, then we have the platform layer, we have the infrastructural layer of data centers and relay switches, we have the satellites above us, we have the marine cables below us. So, of course, we also now have this much-hyped Internet of Things layer, billions of sensors from these biochip transponders inside farm animals to zombie networks of webcams that are being used to mount enormous DDoS attacks. When I think of this work, I think of people like Anne Galloway, Jonathan Stern, Biela Coleman, Paul Dourish, Carlton Gillespie, Nichols, Staroslavsky, Shannon Matten, Kit Loving, Nancy Baim, and Jeff Bowker, among many, many others. All of you have actually shaped my thinking and understanding of these networks of internet governance. But I want to share a new problem with you tonight. Basically, we have a situation where machine learning and artificial intelligence layers are being rapidly deployed into our social systems. And I think they are now posing some very hard questions about control and governability. So to be clear, I'm going to be talking about narrow AI tonight. That's the kind that performs specific tasks. It sometimes has personalized, feminized names like Siri, Cortana, Alexa, and Viv. But most of the time, these are faceless, nameless back-end systems that could be doing things like, for example, image recognition in Facebook and Google. And their intelligence, such as it is, depends on ingesting as much data about us as possible in something that Shoshana Zuboff has called surveillance capitalism, this twin imperative of engineering and finance to get as much data as possible because it makes your company look more valuable and it also trains the underlying machine learning algorithms to be smarter, or at least to simulate smartness. Of course, AI will never be truly autonomous from humankind, as Matteo Pasquinelli has written, and neither will it be free from the vagaries of capital. It is both distinct from, and I think imbricated within, human governance systems. But crucially, AI and decision support systems are now moving beyond what we've traditionally called the internet, this sort of weird exploded category that keeps getting bigger. They're now being infused in this wide range of social institutions, influencing who is released from jail, what kind of treatment you'll get in hospital, to shaping the very news that you see. Now, I know many people in this room were as fascinated as I was last month when we saw that Facebook decided to censor a very famous Pulitzer Prize-winning image of a 9-year-old girl fleeing napalm bombs in the Vietnam War. What was interesting about this process was that we still don't know for sure what combination of automated content detection and human teams actually made this decision, and that's a very interesting set of interface questions there too. But of course, the image of a naked girl is going to trigger a set of automated processes that say this is a violation of our policies. So what did happen is that the image was removed. People noticed this removal, and we had a massive international outcry to the point where the Prime Minister of Norway was saying that Facebook was effectively redacting our shared history. So the image was returned back to Facebook. What was Facebook's return to Facebook? And you might think this is a very happy story. What I would like to suggest is that I think it's actually a rare instance of where we get to see this kind of process happening. It is a tip of an iceberg that is predominantly these kinds of decisions simply don't get that kind of attention. And rarely do we have a Pulitzer Prize telling us which images are so important that they simply can't be removed. So what I think is interesting here is that we're pointing to a much larger mass of unseen hybrids of automated and human decision making. Most of these don't garner any attention. They're embedded in these back rooms, they're working at seams of multiple data sets at once with no consumer-facing interface. Their operations then and their rules are not apparent to us, which I think is in itself not necessarily new. There are many opaque or uninterpretable human institutions as well. I love this quote from Hannah Arendt, who was writing about the Pentagon back in the 1970s, and they just started to use large sets of data. And she wrote, "They did not judge, they calculated. An utterly irrational confidence in the calculability of reality became their leitmotif of decision-making." So, she says it well, I think we're having another moment like this with AI, this irrational confidence in the calculability of reality. So how might we do something about this? I want to speak very briefly just about three points so that we can move on to our amazing panelists. The first response might be, well, make them transparent. Open up the black boxes, as Frank Pasquale might say. I think there's going to be some problems with this approach. I have a forthcoming article with Mike Anany, who's also here tonight, where we look at the long history of the transparency ideal and where it just doesn't map very well, particularly to machine learning systems. Some of you will be familiar with how deep neural nets work, but certainly what we can say is the engineers who work on them will say, hey, this is really great at recognizing cats or recognizing human faces, but we don't necessarily know why. Even when you have all the data, all the inputs, the models, and the outputs, you can't necessarily know how a DNN is working. And what's interesting is that just recently, Y Combinator has installed an algorithm that they call HAL 9000, nice one, guys, that is being used to determine admissions to Y Combinator's very hot program. And Sam Altman said, you know, with some pride, we don't know how it works because it can't tell us, which is great, until such time as you are being judged by a system like that or being denied opportunities, and there's simply no way that you will know how it's working. So I think the issue here is that even if we had perfect transparency, it does not equal understanding. So how do we govern what we don't understand? The second approach is that we should think about investigating these systems from the outside. We should poke them and prod them and see what they do and try and do some reverse engineering. I think there's some really excellent examples of how this is being done. I'm particularly thinking here of Christian Sandvig's work in algorithmic auditing. He sadly couldn't be with us tonight, and my thoughts are with him. You might know that he is also the defendant in an ACLU, American Civil Liberties Union case, where they're trying to remove the research restrictions in the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act. It's a really important case, and it's a really good reminder that there are very real legal structures that are preventing us from doing this kind of auditing, this kind of investigation. So finally, the kind of more novel approach that's emerging now is that people say, if we have a problem with governance and AI, AI can fix it. So this is something that we're starting to see from groups like the finance sector, who have been dealing with high-frequency trading algorithms for some time. They've now been creating a weird ecology of trading phenomena that, according to recent research, is now full of predatory machine learning algorithms that are ganging up on other algorithms. It's extraordinary. This is something that Taro Karpi, who's also here tonight, and I have looked at, and it's a truly fascinating set of sub-second phenomena. So in a case like this, it's tempting to want to create something like a police AI, a master algorithm to bring all of the kind of unruly algorithms into line. But I think there are some real traps with trying to build an AI that watches the AI. And what I've been doing is going back to the early books of AI that were written in the 1970s. My favorite is by Joseph Weizenbaum, who was a professor of AI at MIT. And he developed Eliza, the much-loved conversation simulator. But he started to look beyond his field in computer science and started to ask hard questions about the limits of reducing human decision-making to the formalism of computer logic. And he suggested that if we continue to apply artificial intelligence to social systems, it will gradually become, in his words, a slow-acting poison. So, while that might be a pretty dark turn of phrase, I think it's a useful reminder not to be too seduced by AI governance, and that is why we need research communities like this one to continue to develop critical and conceptual frameworks to account for these new machine logics that bind human and non-human rulers together. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Kate. I think there's a whole field in studying naming decisions of things like HAL 9000. So I think we should look more into how science fiction is intervening in decisions about actual technology design. So the second speaker that I'm honored to introduce is Caroline Gerlitz. I should start by saying that Caroline Gerlitz very graciously stepped in for Christian Sandvig. Christian, as Kate already mentioned, couldn't be with us. Many of you know the circumstances under which he cannot be with us, and our thoughts are with Christian at this point, and we hope that we will be able to somehow make up for this at a future AOIR. So Caroline is professor of digital media technologies at the University of Siegen and a member of the Digital Methods Initiative. Previously, she was assistant professor in new media and digital culture at the University of Amsterdam. Her research explores the various intersections between digital media, methods, and economic sociology, with a specific interest in web economies, platform, and software studies, brands, value topology, numeracy, social media, digital methods, and issue mapping. So give a warm welcome to Caroline, please.
Thanks a lot, Cornelius. Great to be here. So we have the nice task to talk about the question, who rules the internet? And after having spent 2 days with all of you guys, I have a very short answer to this, and that is platforms. However, I thought that would be a too easy way out of my task tonight just to answer this, so I'm going to answer the question, so how do they rule the internet? And I have a couple of answers to that. So, first of all, platforms set out very, very strict rules for what users can be, profiles, bots, and also what users can do, friend, comment, share, like, which are very strictly defined in form, but can be kind of open in interpretation. I like to think of that as a grammar of action drawing on the work of Philip Ager, whereas other colleagues such as Anna Helmund and China Bucher today theorized this kind of platform rule as their affordances. Whereas these rules of what users can be and do may seem very rigid in form, they can be open and flexible in interpretation. So before Facebook introduced its reactions, people were using the Facebook like for a number of different purposes, put as effective response, as ironic reaction, as way to gain attention. However, with the introduction of Facebook reactions, each of the single effect was given its very own strict form, and that disambiguated the like button. So rules of what users can do basically slice down user action into quantified and discrete little data points, turning them algorithm ready, and potentially opening them up to be endlessly recombined. However, that recombination is subject to yet another set of rules. Second, platforms create rules who can access their data and determine what can be done with that. In the platform literature, this kind of rule set has been often referred to as the programmability of platforms. And platforms realize that rule through their APIs and their accompanied codes of conduct and documentations, which determine which data can be extracted by whom, how often, in what quantities, and what it can be used for. On the one hand, they incentivize developers to play around with the data to kind of outsource some forms of innovation to them. However, platforms also like to kind of keep the interpretive flexibility of that data in control and adjust the rules surrounding their APIs. And a couple of you have been working with tools to extract data from platforms, have probably over the last years experienced these changing rules and their impact on your own research, seeing the Twitter API change and only allowing platform researchers to access 1% of their sample data, seeing the Facebook API change and limiting Facebook research tool, and last year, Instagram changed its API rules, disconnecting a various number of tools from the API and disallowing researchers to hold platforms accountable. So API rules determine who can participate in a valorizing platform data, but also holding platforms accountable and giving a public account of what actually happens on platforms, as my previous colleague Bernard Rieder argues. Third, when encountering and dealing with platforms, you're not only subject to the rules that platforms themselves set up. Increasingly, engagement with platforms doesn't happen only directly via the platform, but is mediated through alternative clients, cross-syndication software, support apps, which become intermediaries of platform rules and add their very own rules on top of that, creating a kind of cascade of different rules that users have to engage with and which can also create different kinds of fiction. Fourth, the notion of cascading rules can be taken even further. Platforms don't only extend into apps, but also into the web, as many of you have been writing about, through the implementation of plugins, logins, platform facilitated comment sections, or advertising. The rules of platforms are there intermingling and interfering into the rules of open web standards. And if Christian Sandvik would be here today, he would definitely be talking about the ways in which platforms are becoming increasingly central infrastructure role providers of communication and social expression. And in this sense, the platforms create the rules for making web data platform ready, as my colleague Anna Helmand argues, on which so many webmasters rely to grow their audiences. And in that sense, the rules of platforms matter once they extend into the web, even to those who decide to not even have a platform profile in the first place. And finally, there are these various rules regarding content, my fifth point, which include algorithmic sorting of content that operates in a very, very highly situated and contextual way, responding to both data and user action, various legal frameworks, their enforcement or the lack thereof, as the discussion of hate speech in the German Facebook over the last month has shown, but also temporal rules of platform that determine how long is content being shown, at what speed, and how commercial content is being kind of fed in, trying to identify the right time, as Tainer Bucher argues, to be shown in fast-paced feeds. So these different rules, which are definitely not extensive, can be characterized in a number of different ways. So first of all, the rules that platforms create set up a negotiation between an openness and closure of what can be done with platform and their data. They are often partly or completely invisible or opaque. And platform rules not necessarily come by themselves, but are kind of layered with a lot of intermediary rules, leading to a cascading of different kind of rule sets. And most importantly, and this is a point with which I would like to finish today, rules in relation to platforms cannot be discussed without talking about modes of valuation. What counts as value, for whom, and who actually counts? And what is central in the context of platforms is that their rules enact logics of both Taylorist and post-Fordist economies, and their modes of valorization at the very same time. So Taylorism refers to the micromanagement aimed at mass production, efficiency, and scalability, slicing processes into small, countable, and discretized units which can be monitored, evaluated, and scaled up. And this is exactly what platforms do. They allow us to act, but in very kind of fine-grained, data-fied, and algorithm-ready ways. And basically, platforms create the rules for the mass production of social life, as users are incentivized to perform highly specialized actions in a repetitive manner. However, platforms don't earn money from users performing the same actions, from users liking the same kind of content, and developers doing the same thing with platform data. Platforms earn money from exactly what post-Fordist economies evaluate: affect, creativity, cultural and symbolic productions. The rule of platforms are about, to speak with Lazzarato, putting life to work by rendering life in Taylorist data points that can be counted and measured, but also by allowing these data points to be part of interpretation, affective experience, and social relations. The rules of platforms are enacted through counting, informed by what counts and determine who counts. Thank you.
Thank you, Caroline. So we turn to the third and final panelist, and I'm very happy and very proud to introduce someone who is not a scholar, or at least not a full-time scholar, but somebody who actually does things with and through technology. So Fieke Jansen is researches and writes on the politics of data and digital shadows at Tactical Tech. And Tactical Tech is an NGO that does things through technology and that makes the technology usable, accessible, hackable, malleable for people. She hopes to bring more transparency to the global data industry. Prior to moving to Berlin, Fieke worked on the intersection of the internet, social change, and security at HIVOS, I hope I pronounced that correctly, to set up and manage their digital emergency program for human rights defenders and activists. She has also co-authored a book called Digital Alternatives, with a capital A and a capital N. So thank you. Please welcome Fika, and thank you, Fika, for coming and joining us.
So thanks, Cornelius. As he said, I'll be talking a little bit from a different perspective because we mostly work with people on the ground. I want to thank Kate and Caroline. Kate for giving sort of a sketch of the current and the future situation and what are challenges to data and AI, and Caroline for showing the lock-in of the platforms, basically. So when Cornelius asked me the question, who rules the internet? I mean, for me, the answer was quite clear. Of course, it's the big five. I'm not talking about elephants and tigers, but I'm actually talking about the big five: Apple, Google, Microsoft, Facebook, and Amazon. And I think this is a common knowledge. So then I questioned, how did we let it get this far? I mean, if I talk to users, which I usually do for my day job, there's a certain unease with this. Maybe Google grew up as being the alternative search engine, but we all know it's no longer like this. So there's a certain unease, but people are not able to pinpoint what it is. For instance, when we work with activists, we ask them to draw the internet, and most people draw a cloud. This is very different than a physical infrastructure with very big corporations behind it. I was just in Myanmar giving a training where Facebook is the predominant access provider to the internet. And when we asked, so what will happen if the government bans Facebook? And you should have seen their faces, there was disbelief on it, because it's no longer possible. So you talk about democracy, you can question this concept when Facebook has become such an important player in countries. Then in the same world, I was working with an open source company, and they use Gmail as their email provider. For me, this is quite sort of contradictory. So when talking about who rules the internet, my question sort of was this morning, how did we let it get this far? And to maybe not go into the big five right away, I'm going to take a step back, and I want to give two examples of sort of small interventions that raised a lot of questions. And I think this is sort of also where my talk gets inspired from. It's sort of the intersection between activism, art, and politics. Because let's face it, it is political. So my first example was Bitnik. I don't know if some of you know it, but it's an art group, a collective, and they created a darknet shopper. This project is amazing. So they basically created an algorithm that shopped the darknet and bought random stuff for $50. They sent this to a gallery. Of course, what you can imagine, they bought drugs, among other things. So drugs were shipped to this gallery, and then the police walked in, because they figured it out. But then who are you going to blame? The algorithm, the gallery for actually receiving it, or the creators of this darknet shopper? And this was 2015. So when we talk about algorithmic responsibility, we always think about the big companies. But actually, the things that drive a lot of social conversations are the really small examples, where all of a sudden it becomes clear that it's quite difficult. Then the other example I want to give is there's a project called IC Watch. It's done by somebody who's based in Berlin. And basically what he did was, after the Snowden leaks, he made a data set of all the program names that the NSA uses to spy on us. And he scraped LinkedIn. With this, he was able to identify people who worked for the Secret Service. You can have an opinion on this. And I think most opinions are very different. But what was quite interesting is that all of a sudden, because it was a Secret Service, it triggers this debate. What is public and what is private? Because officially, we're not allowed to know who works for a Secret Service, but these are also people who are looking for a job. And where do you look for a job? On LinkedIn. So this sort of triggered an entire discussion, and of course it was unpatriotic, they put people in danger, everything. But isn't it a little bit weird that something that a coder has developed is questionable, yet this is data that LinkedIn sells every day? but we don't question it. So I think like the small creative interventions trigger social discussion about what's acceptable, what's not acceptable, but we fail to sort of extrapolate this and see that the big five, this is basically the bread and butter, and we allow it. So this was sort of my introduction before I go to the big five. Well, I already named them, but I want to unpack two of them. So let's start with Google, maybe the biggest of the big five. And it is quite fascinating because Google started as the alternative search engine, or at least this is what how in Europe it came across. And of course, we got Gmail. It's called Alphabet now. But in 2014, I think they were classified. They were worth $400 billion. They're the second biggest company in the world. This is more than the GDP of Austria, and it's all on our data, and we've never asked that question. So maybe because it's free, we don't ask these questions, or maybe because the companies are so big that it sort of slips out. And the thing is, they're ever present in our lives. So we all know, probably if we start noting it down, we might know 10 services we use. In reality, we probably use a lot more, but we have Android, Gmail, Google Search. These are all quite sort of in our face services we use and we choose to use every day. And then, of course, there's a lot of services that Google offers that have become less sort of in our face. And I think Kate was talking about this as well. When we go into the sensory world, it becomes even more difficult to decide whether you want to be in a lock-in of a company or not. And then my most favorite part about the big companies is it is political. And we did a mapping study about together with the University of Amsterdam and the summer school, like what is the revolving door between governments and companies? And I think in Europe, this revolving door was always sort of maybe present, but it was never talked about. So in Brussels, you have to register how many lobbyists are there. So Google has 9, and I happen to know Google only because we looked at Google by scraping LinkedIn. so you can also use it on them. And 7 of them come from the European Parliament. 7 people used to work for the European Parliament now work as lobbyists for Google. This is a revolving door. And I think these are all the aspects of the big five we don't see. Then I wanted to sort of unpack a little bit Facebook, because it's the other one of the big five. And it's more about scale. Whereas I think as Google's very smart, they have a lot of services, they have so much wealth and power and knowledge, you have to sort of respect them. Facebook has so many users. So according to the latest stats, they have 1,400 million users a month. It's quite a lot. They have 4,300 million likes a day. This is all data we produce. They're worth $190 billion. And there is a lot of political influence. And I think this is the step that we're missing always, the political influence. So where you can see, for instance, the lobbyists who get officially registered, what you see with Facebook is that they have an enormous drive to conquer the global south. So you see all these amazing images about Mark Zuckerberg with the former president of Brazil, Dilma. He's now conquering China. They're trying to roll out Facebook Zero, and they're selling it as the internet. And hardly anybody's questioning, is this the internet? So there's a lot of political influence and political capital. So then the question might be, who rules the internet? Is it only the big five? And this is where it becomes interesting. Because here you could maybe say it's the 1% of the 1%. Because it's not only the big five companies, it's also the very limited amount of people behind it who are financially backing all these companies. They're called venture capitalists. And I find it quite fascinating that they're all centralized in a very specific location in this world. So you have two venture capitalists called Sequoia, and the other one is Kleiner Perkins. They invested in Google, Amazon, Apple, PayPal, and Yahoo. Most of us use all of this. Then you have Peter Thiel, who started with PayPal, sold it, and he became a venture capitalist himself. So he not only started Palantir, which is the best-kept secret of Silicon Valley, but he's also invested in Facebook and LinkedIn. And you have Google Ventures, which is their own venture capitalist, now that they have a lot of money. They invest in Slack, Uber, 23andMe, which is the DNA, swipe your cheek and find your DNA, and over 300 other companies. So it's not just the big five, but in the end, it is a very small group of people who own the internet. And Cornelius asked us to make a provocation. So I thought, maybe also we have to not just focus on the big companies, but take a very critical reflection on ourselves, on how we actually let it go this far. Because we might find it political, but in the end, most people still use it. They're not questioning it. It's free, it's easy, we'll use it. Speaking on experience where I mostly use only open source, it's not so easy. Yes, all these services probably work better, but somewhere you also have to make a decision. And so my question is, like, why do we push the ethics and the social norms that are being pushed by small groups? Why do we question this publicly? But we fail to question and actually act on it that we live in a very centralized society where there's only a very few actors who have centralized knowledge, wealth, and power. And we're actually feeding the beast on an everyday basis. And it's not just us as individuals. Our universities, our governments are doing the same thing. Governments are looking at Facebook and LinkedIn and Google to find the answer to very difficult questions in society. If it was so easy, we would have fixed it already. Universities going away from their own mail providers and using mail providers like Gmail as their decentralized, as their default platform. I mean, we have to become more critical users. Otherwise, we will remain in this lock-in, and we actually don't have to answer that question anymore. That's it.
Thank you. So, thank you very much. So we have heard perhaps not the three most optimistic assessments of the future, present and future of who rules the internet. So I will not delay us, and in order to get to discussion both amongst ourselves and then with you very soon, let me just point out, and I will be brief, one thing. There are people in this room who study internet governance. I think they sort of question, I wouldn't say the assessment, because this question of who rules the internet can obviously be answered in very different ways. But I'm very grateful to Graf von Kielmann's Eck to introducing an important actor in this discussion into the debate that I think was, I wouldn't say missing, because it came up in your assessment, but overall I think at least strongly backgrounded in relation to older or still ongoing governance debates, namely the government and state actors and other actors which contribute to shaping the internet and historically have contributed to creating the internet in the first place. So one thing that I noted down is the open web is apparently already dead, if I listen to your assessments. We apparently either no longer have it or are on the verge of losing it. So I'd like to point that out and to for us to consider who these different actors are, and that the government is maybe another actor that plays a role. So I will not delay longer. Kate, in a nutshell, I'm simplifying, said that AI perhaps not rules the internet, but is an important force in shaping the internet. Would that be correct?
Well, I think it's really difficult to pinpoint this thing that we call the internet. Mm-hmm. I think that's going to be a really interesting question for all of us in this room who think about these questions and research them. And for me, what I find really interesting about the sort of the turn to automated and semi-automated decision-making systems is that they've been with us for a while. They're underlaying a whole series of networks, and in many ways, you may not even be aware that they're there. So in terms of how they act, it's less about, you know, are they ruling, and it's less about who, and it's less about the internet. I think each one of those terms is starting to get very seriously fractured into a set of questions, which are more about what and about sort of these entanglements of forms of governance. And I think AI is becoming a very significant actor very quickly. Yeah. And to echo what Fika was saying, which I think is really interesting, is we talk about the top five, you know, the big five technology companies. I mean, in the AI world, it's incredibly concentrated. I'd probably say seven, because we'd include, say, Baidu and IBM. But that is seven companies who aren't just, you know, delivering us email or giving us platforms, they're deciding how we get into university or not. That is a system that will determine healthcare. That is a system that will determine whether or not you get housing. And these are filtering far beyond what we traditionally understand as the internet. So that's the governance layer that I think is most interesting to me right now, and I think governments do have a role to play there.
So I noted down one question, I made many notes and have many questions, but one thing that stuck out to me is a question that you asked, and I will force you to answer it or try to answer it, which is, how do we govern what we don't understand? How do we maybe begin to govern what we don't understand? What could be paths to governing?
Thanks, Cornelius. Now you're that's the hard question. Look, I have to say, if there's something that keeps me up at night, it's that question, that we look to governments to figure this out and to know exactly what to do. And of course, governments are looking to us. They're looking to a combination of people who are academics, who are in the technology sector, sometimes also activists and people on the ground and NGOs. And everyone's looking at each other saying, how do we deal with these systems? I think what we urgently need to do is to produce some really strong interdisciplinary research groups working on these issues. Certainly that was part of what we tried to do around AI Now, was to bring people from very different fields together. I know that's something that a lot of people here understand the value of, but I think we're still spreading the word around why interdisciplinarity is going to be crucial. I don't think these issues can be solved by computer science alone. I don't think they can be resolved by social science or critical humanities alone. I think we have to be working together. That's, to me, how we're going to figure out how the systems work and then potentially think about what kind of governance systems are appropriate. I'm not going to pretend that's easy. Right. I think it's the biggest challenge facing us for the next 50 years.
So a call for more interdisciplinary research that obviously needs a lot of funding in the future.
Luckily, we have someone in this room who could do something about it.
So, Carol, to turn to your comments, I was at a Council of Europe event in Estonia last week, and there was also discussion about the role of Facebook there, and there was critique of the Facebook newsfeed and the biases inherent in the Facebook newsfeed. And then somebody said, well, calling for regulation or saying, what about somehow regulating? And then the response to that came was, imagine Europe would somehow decree what the Facebook newsfeed should look like. Like, have a quota, like it exists in France, for 25% content of a certain variety or things which are good for democracy. How would that fly with users? And what I'm trying to say is this, you know, what if others are making the decisions that you were saying are made by the platforms? Not only will that work, but won't that put the government into even more disrepute than it is presently enjoying? Is that not bad?
Maybe not in relation to Facebook, but in relation to Twitter. This is partly already happening. So during our digital methods workshop yesterday, it was addressed that some countries are able to allow the deletion or the kind of the hiding of certain content on Twitter, but that this kind of content can be made visible again via the API. Yeah. So this is already in place in the various different kind of forms. And also, what is also in place is the fact that content is constantly kind of situated and localized based on your specific location. So we are dealing in a situation where imagining like national governments having some kind of influence is on the one hand completely weird. However, location has a very strong influence on what content is being shown and what you can actually encounter. So the kind of the uncanny notion of, yeah, location is can be detected. And I would actually like to also add something to the question that you asked to Kate, and the starting of the discussion, and that is answering the question who rules and with platforms or with specific actors, and the actors that we drew up, they rely on the kind of distributed accomplishment all. So I think Fika nicely pointed that out in her presentation that, yeah, platforms cannot be accounted by themselves, but they require on the engagement of users who basically have to use them. So those different actors who are involved in ruling are all reliant on the involvement of other actors.
And okay, but is there an alternative? If I forced you to propose some sort of alternative, what would that alternative be? You know, to the what we have. How else should we be running these things? But there's the Chinese option, you know. There's the Chinese option. There's the Russian option. There are many options. Are there any better options than what we have?
That is a question I think I cannot answer in this kind of few sections. This is a question I would like to kind of put back to all these 500 smart people, and I think we should spend the next 2 days thinking about that. My answer, because I can't just kind of escape by giving it back to the audience, my answer would be to acknowledge that kind of distributedness as to which we have to respond and react, and to understand that we cannot understand maybe algorithms or AI per se, but have to understand how they operate in specific situations and adjust our regulations and our lawmaking maybe to the fact that there is no one understanding of that.
Okay, so I'll step up the detraction even a little bit more, and Fike, what you talked about, so putting it as extreme as possible, A, are we whining because we as Europeans are feeling essentially sort of colonized by companies from another country, which are extremely dominant, and are we sort of, you know, using our iPhones and other things, and then saying in a moment of rapt reflection, this is all really bad, and then we go back to checking our status. You know, what I'm trying to say, and I'm not, I am serious a little bit, because you can have endless panels like this one, right, debating how bad this all is, and I mean, is something really going to happen that changes this? And I don't say this being such a pessimist, I say this, if people really did care that much, then maybe more would happen. I believe, said they don't act because they can't, because they're not powerful enough. And, you know, people have acted around the environment in very strong ways. They have acted around a lot of social issues in very strong ways. So maybe the problem is this is not a significantly big issue for many people?
I think there's a few issues around this. Okay. And one is...
Good.
Do I think where Europeans are uncomfortable with American, from a libertarian point of view, trying to influence the continent? Yes. I think if you would phrase it this way, because I think what I see not only in Europe, because I mostly work in other parts of the world, so not in America and mostly not in Europe, but in different parts of the world, is that the internet is always seen as something, still something magical, it's neutral, technology is seen as something neutral. And those who research it, who know it, who code, they know it's not. But the thing is, like, it's very difficult for people to have frameworks to think about data, internet, they're very abstract concepts. If you ask somebody, for instance, in Asia, you ask them, do you use WeChat? And they say yes. And you say, why do you use it? And my friends are on it. And then you ask them, so who owns it? And they're like a Chinese company, and all of a sudden this light bulb appears on their head. Because it's very difficult to make sort of critical choices on things that are very abstract. So I think once you put it back into a rhetoric or a political framework that actually works for people, how they grew up, it becomes at least easier to understand it. And this is not being derogative, but it is if in South America, I think the best way to rile a conversation is to say that Facebook Zero is the new form of colonialism. Trust me, you have a political conversation. If you keep it to Facebook Zero itself and access to the internet, nobody engages. So I think it's also about framing it in a way that actually makes people, that fits their reality. And then I think that's only part of the problem. I think the other part is that people are really uncomfortable, but it's difficult to pinpoint why. And it is because we still think, as users, that how difficult can it be? It's maybe about the one text message we send. It's about the one email that maybe Google reads. It's about the one Facebook post. But It is about the entire data set. It's about the patterns and behaviors that is actually interesting, and it's about the data that you actually cannot control, because we still think about control in a way I control whether I send an email, whereas most of us know it's no longer on that scale anymore. So then it becomes very abstract again for people to sort of wrap their mental frameworks around. And I think these are two very difficult things in when you talk about, are Europeans just whining, or like, is it all this dark? Because if you don't, if you're not in this field of internet research, most people have not thought about it in ways.
It's interesting because I think about your provocation that, you know, why are we still using these systems when we could actually make a choice to leave? I do worry though that we're trying to put so much responsibility onto individuals to sort of step away from the evil platforms, when as in reality there are so many reasons why people can't. The opportunity costs to employment, to their friends, to their families are so high. But even beyond those arguments, which I think have been made for years, there's this new argument, which is that even if you didn't use Facebook, even if you didn't use Gmail, even if you didn't have an iPhone, it actually doesn't matter anymore. If you're walking down the street, you're being collected by a whole range of sensors. If you are engaging with people who are also using those devices, you are then part of this broader tracking universe. So what is interesting is that this idea that we still think we have agency about our participation in these processes at an individual level. I really don't think we do anymore, or at least that sense that we do is very rapidly diminishing.
Yeah, I completely agree. And this is what I meant with saying sort of we have a feeling it's still about the one individual piece of data we transmit, whether it's usually about all the data that's collected that's beyond our control. So, but I agree with you, but what I don't agree with is that I find it frustrating that that means then we roll over and die. Whereas I do think like we should stand up and like make different choices, and maybe that skews to, that tips the scale 5%, but that might actually allow room for other interventions to happen and other critical questions to happen and maybe other mechanisms to play.
I think that's interesting. Then we could talk about your question, Cornelius, which is like, what are the political levers? Yeah. Rather than assuming this consumer choice model is going to be enough to change things, that actually it's when we stand up collectively and start talking about, okay, well, what is acceptable, what's not acceptable, what are ethical parameters, what are legal parameters, what are technical parameters. I think that seems to have a lot more potential than a kind of consumer choice, I'm not going to buy, you know, this non-fair trade coffee kind of version of dealing with technology. But I think it's going to be, I think this is what concerns me most, is that I don't think we yet have sufficient collective models of how we think about changing information ecologies. And they're starting to move into so many new areas of everyday life that I think that's the big challenge.
So I think we, instead of rolling over to die, we should assert our agency now and take all of you, integrate all of you into the discussion. So there are mics. They will be passed around. Yeah, so please wait until the mic reaches you. Please state your name. And please be aware that that this is being recorded. So if you would rather ask a question later on without being recorded, you can do that after the panel.
Hello, I'm Martin Schmidt from the Center for Contemporary History in Potsdam. Thank you for this wonderful talk and this wonderful perspectives on the question, who rules the internet? I want to make two points, point two questions. First of all, what is about infrastructure? So you talked about a lot about like the application layer, but below that there's a whole infrastructure. I just published a book about how in the 1960s the protocols of the internet were being developed by certain groups and how they realized their interests into this protocol. It is called Internet in the Cold War or Internet im Kalten Krieg. So what about the infrastructure question? For example, if you're saying, Fike, that you think that, for example, those 1% of the 1% are owning the internet, then I want to pose the question, do they also own like the infrastructure? A wonderful example is Facebook. They're trying to bring balloons into the air, bringing the internet to every part, because they just can be cut off because they don't own the infrastructure. The second thought is just, if you pose this question, who rules the internet, 10 years ago, the question, the answer will directly be you. So what happened to this wonderful thing of Web 2.0 enthusiasm, which changed a way of dominance of Microsoft, of dominance of certain big companies, And this happened in the history quite often. So I think, I'm not proposing this, but I think it can happen again. And so what about the thought about the hot new thing, or next new thing?
Wants to answer? Who identified the question in the somewhat of a comment that was?
I can answer part of the infrastructure question. I'm not an infrastructure expert, but I think, Kate already mentioned in the beginning of her talk, there's so many levels to who owns the internet. The balloons are actually part of Google Loons project, and Facebook is the Facebook Zero. So they piggyback on the telco infrastructure in countries, whereas Google Loon does hot air balloons where they have Wi-Fi, they offer Wi-Fi to people in the global south. Yeah, the infrastructure question, I mean, it used to be owned by governments, or at least in Europe. I mean, you had the telco networks, and then you had sort of some of the IXPs. This has all been privatized. Do you have new sea cables being rolled out? These are partly owned by companies, mostly owned by companies. They're mixed bags between European Union funding together with Google funding, together with sort of philanthropist funding to reach people in Africa, the new sea cables that got put down. Brazil wanted to put a sea cable in between Brazil and Africa to be less dependent on the centralization of the infrastructure around the US, which so far has not been implemented. So I think the infrastructure is also majority owned by companies. I don't know if you want to say anything about that.
I think I have a slightly different view. I actually think that infrastructure studies have been extraordinarily rich in the last few years. I mean, I think of the work of Nicole Starosilski, who I mentioned earlier, but outside of academia, artists are doing extraordinary work around infrastructure. You could think about people like Trevor Paglen doing work with undersea cables. We have artists who are doing really interesting work around thinking about satellites. I mean, this is very much of the moment. I think the infrastructure question is very much sort of front and center. The question then becomes is, what happens next? Now that we have these infrastructures that are not just highly dominated by a small set of companies, but deeply captured by the intelligence communities, what do we do in terms of thinking about these so-called liberatory infrastructures that we would perhaps like to be the next new hot thing? There are obviously activists who have been trying to do things like local area mesh networks, things that are somehow less captured. There's also somebody here in Berlin who is developing, this is Frank Rieger of the Chaos Computer Club, who's developing a system thinking about how you block down stingrays. These are sort of police intercepts around cell phones at protests. He's currently developing a system that will actually shut those down so that you can make sure that if you're at a protest and you look at your phone, it'll be like, this is not a real network. This is a police phishing scam. So there are people thinking about these questions, I think, in a both sort of academic and very practical ways. I think it's hard work, but I think it's really important.
Zizi had a question, I think.
We haven't answered the you question.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't want to. My bad. Excuse me.
Yeah, just very briefly, you had the second question on 10 years ago, we would have said you. I don't think that we would have said that. The question is who would have said that, and the platforms would have said that you are ruling because they provide the infrastructures for users to take it into any kind of direction they want. They wanted, or developers. So a very different crowd would have said you. I think if you would have asked all of us 10 years back, maybe wouldn't have said platforms, but social media networks, but that would basically be something similar. So the you has never, I think, been imagined by academics to be the big ruler.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. This is working. I'm Zizi Papakarisi from the University of Illinois at Chicago. Thank you so much for such interesting opening remarks. And Cornelius, a wonderful job moderating and asking important questions, and then answers that are so inspiring have me have a million thoughts going through my head that I actually had to write my question down, so I'm going to read it. So I wonder whether the real problem is that we're running on very, very dated systems of governance that were built to run worlds that are very different from the world that we live in now. Mm-hmm. And you kind of sort of see this dissatisfaction with the ways in which people are responding to elections and referenda in very irrational ways, to go back to what you were saying, Kate, this past year. So, Cornelius, to return and maybe press on the question that you asked, you know, perhaps not Russia or China, but is there a better form of democracy or democratic governance that we simply have not arrived to yet? Or in other words, you know, after democracy, what? Or is AI perhaps a way for us, something that's there to help us to get to the better form of governance?
Zizi, what a beautiful and impossible question. I love it.
I don't know the answer, that's why I'm asking.
The future of democracy and AI, done. Look, I apologize for the sort of paltry answer that I can give you, but I would like to echo that a lot of people are thinking along these lines right now. And certainly, part of the reason that I do the work I do is so that we can better inform AI systems to ensure that these kinds of democratic spaces can be preserved and, who knows, possibly augmented. I think that is perhaps one of the great optimistic visions. I think that will be, hence my sort of, you know, passion for really building up research in this space, because we don't have a lot of work to go on to answer that question. We can imagine it, but instead, the imaginative space, I think, has been really dominated by a very sort of small group of people who are really just interested in like the superintelligence and how we think about, you know, sort of killer robot overlords. I want to ask that question. I want to ask, how do communities get involved in designing systems, AI systems that might be relevant to their local areas? That is something that we could think about in a co-creative way, drawing on ethnographic practice, sitting alongside leading-edge machine learning. That inspires me. Mm. So I want to see what that would look like, and I just think it's a lovely thing to work towards.
There's a question in the background from...
Hello, Cornelius Puschmann, University of Huddersfield. I just wanted to take up that theme that Zizi mentioned there, in the sense that, do we need to rethink what we mean by democratic control in the sense of what constitutes the demos in internet regulation? Because the theme that I think sort of carries through our plenaries and through a lot of the panels is we talk about regulations, etc., and a lot of concepts that are very closely associated with the nation state, which naturally isn't the category through which most of the internet operates, either in its regulation or in its content. So do we actually need to be more than communication scholars and probably slightly more social theorists or sociologists and re-engage with the question of globalization and the demos to a much greater extent?
I might have a provocative answer for this. Like how Caroline said, who's the you in Web 2.0 and who created this narrative? I also think that the narrative about how the nation state is no longer the power holder in governing the internet is also a mantra that gets sold from a very specific economical point of view. Where last time I checked, I still pay taxes to a country that actually does apply rule of law and that does have power. And by ignoring the fact or underestimating the power they have, it's actually buying into this promise that this comes mostly from the internet tech community. So, of course, I mean, I'm not an internet governance or policy person, and of course there's a lot of challenges and it goes across borders, but I do think that we have to really critically examine where this mantra comes from, because last time I checked, it didn't come from sort of the people or the governments, but it came from somewhere else.
I actually had the Declaration of Independence of the Internet from Perry Barlow. Initially, I wanted to quote that to you, but it was completely unnecessary because we went down that road anyway without doing that. Of how did we end up? How did we get to the point where we are now? From a point where originally people had very lofty ideas about borders and taxes and all the things that you just mentioned no longer being relevant. Anyway, questions? Otherwise, I will just...
Just up the back. I was one here at the front.
Yeah.
And another at the back.
Hello, I'm Meredith Whitaker from Google.
Thank you. You're.
Yes, I am. Good evening. I think this is an interesting question, but it's also sort of pointing to some of the stuff all of the panelists have said, which has been really fascinating. If this question were pointing to some deeper truth, it would be a lot easier to answer, right? You have a linear relationship. There is a ruler. There is an internet. Mm-hmm. And there is then someone you can confront with the impacts of these incredibly complex and, often unintentional systems, right? So I think it would be interesting to me to rephrase this potentially. How do we have agency over the capabilities that a proliferation of network technologies have enabled us to either benefit or not benefit from, and how do we even know what those are and determine a relationship between what these technologies do and how we are impacted in our many different ways?
It's a great title. It would have been hard to fit on the program, but yeah. I love it. And I want to just agree with that just very quickly before passing to the other panelists that it's a really comforting fairy story to think that there is a who at the top and or like one company or even just like a small cluster of companies, and if you could only just get past that all of this would be resolved. I think there's something much more interesting in the way that you phrase this question, which is to think about, well, if there isn't this sort of monadic sort of singular center of power, if it's so dispersed, if it's so complex, what are the ways that we engage with it? And I think there are ways. That's the sort of really optimistic part. But I think we've got to do a lot of work to get there.
Yeah, one way to think about engaging and to think about agency in this kind of very distributed setup of actors is to think about maybe dissent. And that can connect to the question Zizi had before. So how can we imagine more democratic infrastructures that are so distributed, that are infrastructures that enable dissent, that allow the different actors to pursue their different objectives, forms of valuation, to follow what they think is relevant for their own life without kind of interfering in what maybe other actors consider relevant for them, or negotiating that on a level that kind of not only enables platforms to make sure, okay, they have enough kind of net value at the end of the year. So the kind of dissent of objectives that is being enabled by infrastructures would be one way, I would suggest, to think about modes of agency in these distributed environments.
So I think now we've complicated all aspects of the title, both the who, the ruling, and the internet. And there's a question in the back, I hear. So perhaps that question will...
I'm here, Felix Münch from Queensland University of Technology, actually German. So the last time I was forced to give away my data was by the Australian state. During the census, where I was asked, like, where was I 5 years ago? How much housework did I do the last weekend? Whom was I living with? Where I was the day before, like, whether I'm married or not, and in what the relationship I am with my flatmate. And I had to fill it, otherwise I have to pay a fine of, I don't know, I think it tops at $1,800. Facebook never asked me to do that. And Twitter neither, and still when I want to go on the internet, and also that's the same for everybody else who has some technical knowledge, I can be quite well still under the radar of everything. So I'm kind of free. I rule this kind of internet. I would still say that, but you need kind of some technical knowledge. And then I'm wondering on the other hand that why is it that the states that are the best at governing platforms are the states that I want to live in the least. So, and the third aspect that I want to raise is that if North Korea would be a platform, the world would have one problem less because people just would not use it. So, that leads me to my question that might it be that when, as academics, we start to talk about platforms in a kind of alarmistic way, that we say, like, oh, they rule our lives, when actually they don't, because they rely on us as their users. which is kind of a democratic thing. If we start like talking a lot about how to govern those platforms, aren't we actually in danger to go into a direction we don't want to go? And that's more regulation of something that's actually free to join or not by something that I cannot choose because I cannot choose my nationality.
Well, there's so many questions in there. Yeah. I'll just very quickly touch on two. Certainly in terms of the census, and I hear Australia had a particularly rough time of it this year. Apologies to everyone who had to deal with that. I point to the work of Kevin Driscoll, who I think wrote a fantastic article looking at the history of the census as a kind of like an early large-scale data technology. What is interesting in your alternative view is that Facebook didn't ask you if you were married or, you know, how much housework you did. I would actually say Facebook's, A, trying to elicit that information from you in a whole lot of ways, sometimes directly, sometimes indirectly. And the other thing I would say is I'm sure you've seen the University of Cambridge study that shows that with really quite extraordinary levels of accuracy, I can predict whether you are married, what your sexual orientation is, whether you're a drug or alcohol user, based on your Facebook likes. So you're not necessarily, you know, liking anything related directly to those topics, but they looked at how you can do these large-scale correlations. Even when they're wrong, these companies are building up those very detailed portraits of you. So I think that is something that we need to keep in mind, that even if you think you are relatively free, that those kinds of data profiles are being built. But I do agree with you that you know, we have to move past this kind of user-centric model where, like, it's, you know, we have this idea that it's only through the user engagement that you are actually sort of participating in these platforms. I think it's much bigger than that.
Yeah, and I think I just want to add to this because I completely agree. I think it's like, so I badmouth Google a bit this talk. But like states, Google is also not a monolithic entity. There's so many, it's like, it's not one company. There's a lot of people working for it, and each have their own individuality. And I think what you can, the census you brought up is actually quite interesting, because what you see in certain English-speaking countries is actually that the UK, US, and Canada, that the census is done by the biggest arms manufacturer in the world. So you cannot opt out, and actually your data is being collected by Lockheed Martin, who also makes arms. So you could, and you even get a fine if you don't participate. So for me, it's not like, oh, the big five are worse than governments, or, oh, I think the data society makes things very complex, and the thing we need to do is unpack it and start asking the politics and the questions behind it, because if we don't do it, we just take them face value. It's like Shell saying, I take care of the environment, the same like a big data company would say, I respect your privacy. Of course not, it's a bread and butter. So I think it's like making it more complex and actually asking the politics behind it. And I do want to stretch one point that you said was like, if you have some technical skills, then you can fool the system, which I highly doubt. But that also means that you believe in a society where if you have technical skills, you become the elite and you become better than the rest, so it doesn't matter that the people who don't have those skills will then get profiled. So we create a whole new class system based on this. And I think that's even more problematic. So I think there's certain things we need to politicize and actually question. Yeah.
So,
Yeah.
I think in the interest of time, and given that the time is drawing short, I would give the last question to Jenny Stromagalli, the president, of who raised her hand in due order.
I guess I rule.
So the final question is yours.
So the conversation about internet leads to this conversation about boundaries, which leads to these questions of governance. And when I think about governance and how we go about doing governance, that work of policy making and legislation and rulemaking, ideally, those rules are driven by a set of values that collectively we want to uphold in the rules, in the regulations. And so maybe this is a happy way to end, but I'd like to hear your thoughts on what the values need to be that underlie the regulations that structure and shape these systems.
I would start answering these questions, and there are probably many, many different ways to answer it, by values that are relevant, that enable that people are not being kind of discriminated by the effects of algorithmic processing, AI, and so forth, that these kind of processes enable people to participate in various forms of society without necessarily being kind of discriminated on choices on kind they have made in the past. That would be one very important thing. And that requires basically a very kind of detailed understanding of how these kind of discriminatory effects are being kind of enabled. Yeah, but a very specific form of transparency, because by just looking at AI or at algorithms, you don't necessarily know how exactly they will decide in a very kind of situated context in relation to data of specific users. So understanding how these kind of effects are being produced, I think, is absolutely important to make sure that, yeah, they don't constrain participation.
I love this question. I guess I would just briefly add that I think that all of these systems that we've been discussing tonight, from sort of the infrastructural layer to the platform layer to a whole range of sort of super layers of machine learning and beyond, come with them a particular type of values sort of baked within how they work. The minute we ascribe the belief that, you know, with more of these kinds of data systems, we get close to what people really want, and we get close to the truth, we get close to objectivity, we've taken a perspective that has a very certain value with it. I think I'd be really interested in asking what kind of values drop out of those systems, what kind of values don't fit within the easy metricization of human activity. And I think there we can actually turn to, you know, some really interesting work in feminist theory, in race theory, in a whole lot of work that's been done in the 20th century to think about who gets to make the values and how we might think about participation in different ways.
The only thing I would like to add to these values is also the collective, like the social. It's no longer about the individual, because my actions might exclude somebody else now in the data society. So also, like, how can we take responsibility for a larger collective good where everybody believes people should have access to healthcare, education, all these things. And these are exactly the things that get sort of deteriorized in a data society. So how can we also, as our individual values, make sure that the collective is also...
Thank you so much for offering a glimmer of hope that we will be part of ruling
and
not just of being ruled. So thank you so much, and please give a warm round of applause for the panelists, who I think have done a stellar job. And so what remains for me to say is to you, please stick around, have discussions about who rules the internet or other things that you find interesting, and enjoy the reception that we have outside and the drinks. Thank you so much for coming.